shaping up to be an election year like none other. In the backdrop of the pandemic, technology, mis- and disinformation are making journalists and voters work hard at digging into the truth. Joining us now is Aimee Rinehart, U.S. Deputy Director of First Draft, a global organization aiming to provide practical and ethical guidance for how to find, verify, and publish content sourced from the web. Welcome, Aimee.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Tell us a little bit about what First Draft does.
Well, we started in 2015 as a way to build protocols and standards around verifying things that you would find on the social web. And after the election in 2016, there was this huge interest in fake news. While fake news wasn't new, there was a huge interest in it. 2 weeks after the election, President Trump called it, or then President-elect Trump called it, fake news. And we've been kind of holding on by our fingertips ever since. We have really pivoted to create collaborative verification projects in France, Brazil, the UK, and right now we're doing an election project in the U.S. where we have a Slack community where we send signals every day to newsrooms about things that we're surfacing, narratives that we're seeing, trying to make sense of it for local newsrooms in particular, who are the targets of a lot of problematic content this election cycle.
Sure. And when it comes to that kind of mis- and disinformation for this election cycle, what trends are you seeing?
Well, some of it is kind of the old stuff that we've seen again. I mean, the stuff that trends on the social web is anti-globalist, which is a shorthand for anti-Semitism. We see a lot of anti-Black rhetoric, anti-Muslim rhetoric, anti-immigrant. So basically the othering of people, we see that with the nomination of Kamala Harris as the vice president. It's the reinvention of the birthergate, where there are assertions that are untrue, that she was not born in this country, and she's not eligible to be vice president or president should Joe Biden be elected and not be able to serve. So, that also slices it a little bit into misogyny for her as well, because there's real questioning, at least on right-leaning pages, of whether or not she's fit and capable to run for president. And I think we've seen that she's more than capable, and she holds her own, but we'll see if she can endure this tidal wave of problematic content that's aimed directly at her because of her biracialness, because of her being a woman, because she was a prosecutor in San Francisco.
And can you tell what is the purpose generally of this mis- and disinformation? Is to damage a candidate? Is it to sow division? I mean, to sow confusion? I mean, what ultimately is the goal and the purpose, and how effective has it been?
Well, I mean, the ultimate goal is to persuade action, right? To put one candidate in over another. And I think for a disinformation campaign to be successful, you merely have to insinuate doubt. So President Trump has been great at insinuating doubt and defunding the United States Postal Service. So now the question is, I don't know if I can really trust the U.S. Postal Service to deliver my ballot, that the U.S. Postal Service won't even deliver a ballot to me to vote with. And how could I trust it then going in? And then once we get the election results, probably several weeks after the election is meant to take place, because of the paper ballot, the amount of paper ballot counting, it will install doubt that people cannot trust the validity of that election and the election outcomes. So again, it only has to insinuate doubt, and there has been doubt seeded around the USPS's capabilities around delivering this election fairly and with the intentions of the founding fathers to have a fair and equal election.
Sure. And of those trends that you're seeing, I mean, what are the most concerning to you as someone who does this and looks at this all the time?
I mean, the division between people, the race baiting, is really problematic. Our team is diverse, and we've asked them to look at some of the worst parts of the internet for this. It's a very cynical space. It's a space that that preys on people's fears. And after a while, that eats away at you. We have people looking at conspiracy theories, and I asked our team in London, the 5G conspiracy theory was particularly particularly strong there. And I asked, is there a part of you that starts to believe this? And she said, you know, kind of. Like, you start to think, well, that does make sense. Why, you know, and you start to understand how these movements and ideas begin to gain traction, because it's just that whisper of doubt around some component. And with 5G, the 5G map lays over where coronavirus has been hit hardest by. And so if you can make some kind of comparison, you're able to then make that leap that 5G is causing coronavirus.
Okay. And this may sound like an obvious question, but with seemingly, you know, people taking to their own respective corners more and more, are the left and the right both guilty of this kind of mis and disinformation?
I mean, it's not a symmetrical fight. The right leaning pages and posts are much more prominent. The top 10 pages and posts within Facebook daily, according to CrowdTangle, almost without fail, Ben Shapiro he's a right leaning influencer. He usually has 5 of the top 10 posts. The right-leaning pages tend to invoke more outrage. They've gotten very good at social media. They felt like they were squeezed out of mainstream media and have taken to platforms and really developed their audiences, really have a message honed. They often repeat each other's messaging. And so the keywords, which is how we find this stuff, are often repeated. And it's amazing to see how well coordinated they are. What we saw around the coronavirus was a real libertarian streak, which in some ways was a relief for our team. I mean, I get tired of thinking, is this a right or a left issue? And libertarian strikes right in the middle. So what we saw around reopen protests were a lot of coordination around libertarian movements, whether that's the anti-vaccination community, the Second Amendment community. They were able to come together around these reopen protests in a way that they hadn't before. And not necessarily the problem with that, but the problem that we could see with that is that those are networked communities. They know who they are. They know who each other's are. They are on groups. They have Facebook groups. They have WhatsApp groups. They have Telegram groups where they're able to coordinate their messaging and get out there fast. So in some ways, it's a modern Minuteman where they're able to get to the downtown area and invoke their freedom of speech by declaring that we shouldn't be wearing masks or that we should be reopening schools now.
And is there any evidence yet in this voting cycle that any of these mis or disinformation campaigns have had an effect on voters thinking? Maybe it's in the polls or in other data. Is there anything that shows that one way or another yet?
Shows what?
These campaigns have had an effect, like any of the mis or disinformation campaigns have had an effect on the way voters view the candidates or view the issues.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this stuff is a slow drip. And I think what we've seen and what research has shown is that it's a repeated mantra again and again and again that wears at people, and that we are busy. Even in the pandemic and in lockdown, we're still busy people. We have 4-inch screens. We're scrolling very quickly. And we often don't pause to think, is that true? Suddenly you just think, oh, Joe Biden was sick or Trump was sick. And then that lingers in your mind when you think about who has the health to become president and stay president for 4 years, because that's the ideal situation. So it's that steady flow of the constant bombardment. Trump is excellent at staying on message. He just beats that drum again and again that Joe Biden is a socialist Democrat. Joe Biden is not a socialist Democrat. He's probably the most center of all the candidates who were up this year, but that doesn't matter. Trump says it. He says it again. He's got 10 other people who support him, who repeat that mantra. They throw a photo up of AOC and Joe Biden maybe shaking hands, and it's over. That has a steady and slow erosion on people's trust in the system and trust in people and what they're able to do, and even that person's narrative. And Joe Biden, we have 40, 50 years of his political record as the narrative, but it doesn't matter in the face of one person who has premier influence on social media and on television to command the attention, to command the narrative. And so he does it well, and he's relentless with it, and it has an effect. And sometimes we don't see these effects until election day happens, and then people are like, I didn't see that coming. But he's very powerful and strong at consistent messaging. And that is something where, if we're comparing Democrats to Republicans, Democrats are not. They have a much more fractured message, and that is really hard to get others to embrace, because they're not sure what it is they're embracing. And with Trump, you're always sure what you're probably going to get with him.
And so for people who are consuming social media and consuming news, what are some red flags that they can look for on social media or in the news that they consume that they might be taking in mis- or disinformation?
I think it's that gut instinct that, oh my gosh, that's so funny, if you're seeing a meme. And the reason why it's so funny is because it usually has about 10 or 15% of truth in it, and the rest is just made up hyperbole to get you to feel something. So if you feel something on your social media page, and it's often outrage, because outrage travels much, has a higher velocity than like middle of the road content, that outrage is a gut check for you to say, you know, I see this assertion. I'm going to see if there are two or three other news outlets that can support this idea. And if I can't find from a mainstream publication, that, and by mainstream I mean the publication has bylines, the publication has a retraction policy or a corrections policy, and publishes on a regular with a regular cadence, then you should start to think I don't think that this is true, or at least the part that resonated with me the most is probably not true. And so you want to then pause the share buttons, or if you do share it, to make sure and put it into context that you're sharing an article from The Onion, which is a satirical website. You're sharing that with the intention to make someone laugh. Sometimes if we send or share things with people in our groups and we don't explain our intention, it can be misinterpreted and shared for other purposes. So you just want to really be clear about what you're sharing on the internet. Read the entire article. Don't just share a headline. I know those things are hard to do, but if we're going to be good stewards of the information we see, these are some of the measures we have to take. And part of that is just slowing down.
Well, thank you, Aimee, so much. Thank you for joining us.
Of course. Thank you for having me.
And thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.